everyone. Let me thank you for taking out time for today's webinar. My name is Dr. Arijit and I shall be your host today. The webinar is being recorded and will be shared on social media platforms later on. Today's webinar will have a Q&A section towards the end, and we would encourage all of you to share your questions for the speaker in the Q&A tab on your devices in the Zoom interface. So without much delay, let's begin. I'll just give you a background of the context and then maybe introduce the speaker. So as you all know, continuous deployment of antimicrobial drugs in treating infections has led to the emergence of resistance among various strains of microorganisms, whether it be bacteria, viruses, fungi, or parasites. Multidrug resistance is the insensitivity of a microorganism to the administered antimicrobial medicines despite earlier sensitivity to it. As a matter of fact, this problem is so big that the WHO has declared that the antimicrobial resistance is one of the top 10 global public health threats facing humanity. And it's one of the core agendas of WHO. So let us hear more on multidrug resistant pathogens, which is a serious patient safety challenge, from our speaker today, Dr. R. Anita. Dr. R. Anita is currently working with Dr. Kamakshi Memorial Hospital, Pallikaranai, Chennai, as a consultant microbiologist and a hospital infection control officer. She's also the nodal officer for COVID-19 at Dr. KMH Hospital. She has over 6 years of experience in emergency care and DMO. 3 years of experience while her MD program as a clinical microbiologist and tutor. She also then served as a consultant microbiologist in Prashant Hospital in Velachery. And after that, she joined over at Dr. Kamakshi Memorial Hospital, Chennai. After pursuing her MBBS program from Thoothukudi Government Medical College, which is under Dr. MGR Medical University, she went on to complete her MD in microbiology from Chettinad Hospital and Research Institute, Chettinad University. And over the entire period, she has presented in various forums and published research papers in various index journals. Her areas of interest are clinical microbiology, primarily trying to drive more focus around evidence-based diagnosis and helping clinicians treat better, be a part of hospital infection control and biomedical waste management programs, to set up antibiotic policies to help clinicians treat patients more effectively and evidence-based. She also has interests to support the infectious disease agenda, to be part of the infectious disease specialty team, and to look after infectious disease patients and help the infectious disease specialist provide proper antibiogram report. And these are emerging, these are so dynamic, changing all the time. So it's a complex area, it's an evolving area, and we all know how critical this is today and as we go forward into the future. So without much delay, let me request Dr. Anita to talk us through this important area and what is in store for the future and how do we deal with it currently. Over to you, ma'am.
Very good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for the introduction. It's my great pleasure to be here to discuss about the given topic on this platform. And the topic is multidrug resistant pathogens, serious patient safety challenge. So as we all know that the infections caused by multidrug resistant bugs has been increasing worldwide. As a medical fraternity, it is our responsibility to follow certain infection prevention policies and protocols to combat such infections, to curb the spread of infections caused by MDR bugs. So the agenda of this session will be discussing about multidrug resistant bugs and the mode of transmission and so antimicrobial resistant development, like the factors promoting AMR, and about antimicrobial stewardship program and IPC policies and protocols to be established at healthcare settings, And so what are the steps can we take to curb such spread, curb the spread of antimicrobial resistance in future? So let me share the screen with the PowerPoint slide. So, is it visible? Can you all see?
Yes.
Is it visible? Yes.
Yeah, maybe request Mr. Sundar Patriot to kindly mute.
Sorry?
Mr. Sundar Patriot is on the panel. Can we request Mr. Sundar to kindly mute you? Thank you so much. Yeah, ma'am, you can continue.
Can I proceed? Can I proceed,
yes.
Sir?
Yes, ma'am.
So the agenda of this session or introduction about MDR bugs. Introduction about MDR pathogens and WHO categorization of priority pathogens and the factors promoting antimicrobial resistance and the rising trend of antimicrobial resistance, which is the greatest challenge to patient safety, and prevention and control of AMR and setting up of antimicrobial stewardship programs and the IPC policies, that is infection prevention and control policies, and finally just to conclude with antibiotic awareness week. So MDR pathogens, a challenge to patient safety. Yes, of course, it is a great challenge to patient safety. It poses the greatest threat to human health across the globe, and especially it's prevalent in hospitals, nursing homes, and among patients requiring devices such as ventilators and CVCs. So it is prevalent in each and every part of the country, in every country, although the severity may vary, but it's been distributed worldwide. So it leads to a lot of dreadful diseases and its complications. So as a medical fraternity, it is our responsibility to respond to certain strict infection prevention and control policies to mitigate the spread of infections caused by multidrug resistant bugs. So MDRO, this multidrug resistant organism. So what is MDR? So these are organisms that are non-susceptible to active, that is one drug in three or more antimicrobial categories that the isolate is expected to be susceptible. Usually that isolate is expected to be susceptible to the drugs, but in the MDR bugs or non-susceptible, first and foremost factor here to mutate and to be resistant to extensive misuse of antibiotics. So initially, the bacterial population which are resistant will be very minimal, but due to the constant selective pressure of antibiotics, especially in healthcare settings,
Kindly bear with us. We lost you, Dr. Anita.
Is it audible?
Yes. We lost you for a while.
Am I visible? Am I audible? Yeah.
You may present, share your screen once more.
Okay. Once again. Is it visible, sir? Is it visible?
Yeah, it's visible.
So invisible. Is it audible?
Yes.
Can I?
The voice is not stable though. The voice is not very stable. What you can do, doctor, you can switch off your video. That will.
Can I proceed?
Yeah. You may want to switch off your video so that whatever bandwidth is available, you can use it for the audio.
Yes. Yeah. I have switched off my video. Is it okay?
Yeah, the voice is better now, it seems.
Okay. So MDR webs, as I told. நம்மளுக்கு ஸ்டேபிளா தானே இருக்கு. ஹலோ மர்சி, என்னோடது ஸ்டேபிளா தான் இருக்கு மர்சி. இத நான் இது ஆஃப் பண்ணிட்டேன், வீடியோ ஆஃப் பண்ணிட்டேன். என்னோடது கரெக்டா தான், ஆனா உங்களோடது தான் ஆஃப் ஆயிடுச்சு இப்போ. Okay, no problem.
Ma'am, you can continue, ma'am.
I'm not able to see anything.
Yes, ma'am. We couldn't see the screen.
Yes.
Ma'am, you can share the screen and you can continue, ma'am.
One second. I'm not able to see anything here. That's the thing.
The screen share, ma'am.
One second.
Am I audible? Yes, you are audible, ma'am. Couldn't see the screen, ma'am. But you are audible.
Okay, then I'll continue talking.
Ma'am, what we can do, we have the backup of your presentation, so we can start
sharing. Okay, you can do it and I can just talk through this. Okay.
Right.
Okay. So the most important factor for the bacteria to undergo mutation to become resistant, which further flourishes exponentially in the presence of selective pressure of antibiotics. It's mainly due to extensive misuse of antibiotics. So initially the resistant bacterial population will be very minimal, but due to constant selective pressure of antibiotics, due to overusage of antibiotics, these resistant bacteria flourishes exponentially and gradually turns all the susceptible strains into resistant strain. This is how the multi-drug resistant bugs develop. So that results in the development of superbugs. So the superbugs are nothing but these are organisms which are resistant to multiple drugs, which includes multi-drug resistant bugs, pan-drug resistant bugs, and extensively drug resistant bugs. So this is coming to the next slide. This describes about priority pathogens. That is, WHO has classified antibiotic resistant pathogens into three categories. That is, number one is critical pathogens, two is high group, and third is medium. The critical group includes Acinetobacter baumannii and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. These are carbapenem resistant, and Enterobacteriaceae, these are carbapenem resistant and ESBL producers. That is, extended spectrum beta lactamase producers. And the second group, that is high, that includes Enterococcus faecium, which is vancomycin resistant, and Staphylococcus aureus, which is methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, VRSA, that is vancomycin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, and VISA, that is vancomycin intermediate Staphylococcus aureus. And it also includes H. pylori, that is Helicobacter pylori, which is clarithromycin resistant, and Salmonella, that is fluoroquinolone resistant, and Neisseria gonorrhoeae, that is cephalosporin resistant and fluoroquinolone resistant. And finally, medium group, that includes pneumococci, that is Streptococcus pneumoniae, which is penicillin non-susceptible, and Haemophilus influenzae, which is ampicillin resistant, and Shigella, which is again fluoroquinolone resistant. So the critical group pathogens usually causes bloodstream infections and pneumonia, whereas the high and medium group pathogens are associated with food poisoning, and Neisseria gonorrhoeae causes gonorrhea. So these are the categorization done by WHO, so classified as antibiotic resistant priority pathogens. So this is a slide showing the categorization of priority pathogens, again into critical, high, and medium. Next, coming on to the factors promoting antimicrobial resistance. As we all know that extensive and misuse of antibiotics is the foremost factor for generation of new mutant strains of bacteria that leads to multi-drug resistant bugs or superbugs. So since after the discovery of penicillin, antibiotics are highly effective and have saved millions of lives. But at the same time, this has led to the extensive use of antibiotics by the following ways. The first thing is over-the-counter sale without prescription. So the over-the-counter sale without doctor's prescription and antibiotics are sold. And overuse for self-limiting infections and non-bacterial infections and treatment of colonizer on containment. So we should use antibiotics promptly and appropriately. It is not needed for self-limiting infections like viral infection or other non-bacterial infections. So it shouldn't be used for other infections apart from bacterial infections. So use of antibiotic with overlapping spectra of activity, that is redundant antibiotics. See, combination therapy has become popular nowadays, but these combination drugs are often prescribed inappropriately. So the proper combination drugs has not been prescribed. It's an inappropriate prescription of combination therapy. For example, so two beta lactams are prescribed, like piperacillin tazobactam along with ceftazidime for gram negative coverage. So they have overlapping spectra of activity that is of no use. So this kind of redundant antibiotic shouldn't be prescribed. and inappropriate administrative errors, that is wrong dose of antibiotics, wrong frequency of antibiotics, wrong infusion, wrong duration, and missed dose, all these leads to antimicrobial resistant development. And antibiotic use as a growth enhancers in livestock and animal feed and farming and all. So in animals, for non-therapeutic purpose, around 70% of antibiotics are used for non-therapeutic purpose. Around 15% of antibiotics for therapeutic purpose in animals. And irrational use in OP management. Irrational use of antibiotics in OP management that promotes AMR. So this and that increases the severity of illness of those who are admitted to the hospitals. Then causes of antimicrobial antimicrobial resistance. So this is just to brush up. That is again over prescribing of antibiotics, patients not finishing their treatment. So the antibiotics dosage and duration should be pakka, it should be perfect, it should be appropriate. So patients not finishing their treatment and overuse of antibiotics in livestock and fish farming and poor infection control practices in hospitals and clinics and lack of hand hygiene and poor sanitation and lack of new antibiotics being developed. So these are the factors and these are the causes of antibiotics resistant. Coming to the rising trends of AMR, it's the greatest challenge to patient safety. So AMR is a rising threat across the world and it was a major concern. And antibiotic overuse is a major driver of antimicrobial resistance. So as I told before, antimicrobial resistance is prevalent in every country, though the extent and severity may vary. So it is our responsibility to take necessary steps to prevent such spread in future. So the first thing is like New Delhi NDM producing bacteria, which is New Delhi beta-metallo-beta-lactamases. Producing bacteria, which was first reported in 2008, but it has been found worldwide now. And from 2008 to 2013, E. coli resistant to third generation cephalosporins were reported. That increases from 70 to 83%. And resistant to quinolones were increased from 78 to 85%. And 10% of E. coli isolates were resistant to carbapenems in 2008 and increased to 13% in 2013. And resistance to carbapenems for Klebsiella pneumoniae increases from 2% in 2002 to 52% in 2009. It was reported somewhere in India. And finally, in 2010, it was reported that India was the largest world's largest consumer of antibiotics for human health. So around 60% of healthcare associated infections may involve antibiotic resistant bacteria. So relatively, hospital environment harbors a greater magnitude of organisms than that of community, and the transmission of infection by such bugs results in outbreaks. And and most of the bugs sitting in the hospital environment are multidrug resistant bugs. So these are associated with higher infection related costs, long duration of hospital stay, and higher mortality. The immunocompromised patients like cancer patients, HIV patients, and organ transplant patients, these patients are often colonized or infected with unusual and resistant opportunistic organisms. So these opportunistic organisms are more likely cause infections when their immunity is still more compromised. So they're more likely, these patients are more likely to undergo procedures like transplantation, bone marrow transplantation, and device insertion like central line catheter insertion or urinary Foley's catheter insertion and all. So though they are more prone to acquire infections with opportunistic pathogens, so they're increased risk of acquisition of infection. So these are the challenges faced in healthcare settings. So apart from this kind of challenges posed by multi-drug resistant bugs in hospitals, they are now gradually infiltrating into the community. Because as the patient is discharged from the healthcare facility, he carries the resistant bugs with him. So in the community, he still spreads infection with the multi-drug resistant bugs. He's infectious, spreading multi-drug resistant strains in the community. So on the other hand, increased treatment of patients in the community as well can lead to new mutant strain, that is de novo generation of resistant strain in the community. And such strains again can be introduced into hospitals by patients on admission. So it is not only healthcare facilities' responsibility to tackle this threat, it is a community problem as well as healthcare workers' problem. So it is our responsibility as a community as well as healthcare facilities' responsibility to tackle this threat. So this is the algorithm showing how antibiotic-resistant bacteria can spread. See, the infected person, if he stays at home, and he still spreads resistant bacteria to family and friends. But if he goes to hospital or other healthcare facility, he spreads the infection to other patients directly or to other healthcare workers who don't wash their hands properly, who don't follow the infection control practices properly. So again, these patients, when they get discharged, goes home with antibiotic resistant bacteria and again stays at home and spreads resistant bacteria to family and friends. At the same time, the healthcare facility, in healthcare facility, these patients should be cohorted. These patients should be isolated. The healthcare facility could consider isolating such infected patients separately to control the spread of infections, to control the spread of cross infections between patient to patient, between the healthcare workers to patient, patient to healthcare workers, and vice versa. So resistant bacteria spreads to other patients through unclean areas. So proper environmental and cleaning practices should be followed in healthcare facilities. So this is an algorithm showing how this resistant bacteria can spread in the healthcare facility as well as in the community. So in this way, the cycle continues. So this is what the current scenario is. That because of the de novo generation of the resistant strains, so we are running short of antibiotics, especially the last resort antibiotics to treat infections in future. So we should be very careful to preserve last resort antibiotics. Then prevention of antimicrobial resistance. So how to prevent and control the development of antimicrobial resistance? First of all, we need administrative support. In healthcare facilities, we need good administrative support and good management support to implement certain protocols and policies. And we need support in areas of funds and providing infrastructure and resources like manpower, so everything. So we need good administrative support, first of all. Then, as usual, the standard precautions, irrespective of the patient's conditions, the standard precautions should be followed at all times. The proper hand hygiene should be followed, and the contact precautions, isolation precautions should be followed. And stringent hand hygiene program should be conducted frequently and at local and regional levels to create awareness about hand sanitation and hand hygiene practices. And regular training of healthcare worker in areas of infection prevention and control practices should be followed. And cohorting of patients in hospitals. So the patients infected with multi-drug resistant bugs like VRSA or MRSA or carbapenem resistant bugs. These patients should be cohorted, isolated, and to prevent the spread of transmission of infection to other patients. So an antimicrobial policy. So every hospital should set up the antimicrobial policy according to their local antibiogram and the setting up of infection control policies. With the help of ID consultants or clinical microbiologists in a healthcare facility. And judicious use of antibiotics should be advised, should be followed. And formulary restriction, that is, this is one of the front end strategy, that is formulary restriction with the pre-authorization. This formulary restriction, that is, if the clinician, here it's a front end strategy, here the clinicians require approval from antimicrobial stewardship team to prescribe restricted antibiotics, especially higher end antibiotics like polymyxin B, colistin or carbapenems. They should get permission from the antimicrobial stewardship team to prescribe such restricted antimicrobials. And strict regulations to prevent OTC sale, over-the-counter sale. So no drug should be sold without doctor's prescription. And we should create some awareness to the general public that certain drugs should not be consumed without doctor's prescription, especially the drugs with the red line. Shouldn't be consumed with a doctor's prescription. So there should be strict regulations to prevent such over-the-counter sale of antibiotics or other restricted drugs. And de-escalation of antibiotics. So de-escalation of antibiotics for VAP, that is ventilator-associated pneumonia and UTI and etc. That is de-escalation, that is switching over of higher antibiotics, that is broad spectrum antibiotics to narrow spectrum antibiotics. That is switch over from IV drugs to oral drugs based on the culture report, based on the support from lab. Based on the culture report, it can be. And and proper sterilization and disinfection practices should be followed. Proper sterilization and the disinfection practices should be followed. Proper environmental cleaning and proper cleaning of high touch areas and proper cleaning of high critical areas should be followed. The HIC team, that hospital infection control team, should monitor all these practices in healthcare settings. And lab support, good lab support is always needed, that is lab stewardship. There should be clear-cut coordination between clinicians and microbiologists, and there should be timely reporting of cultures by automated methods, which will definitely help the clinician to start the patients on antibiotics or required antibiotics. So the patient can be started on empirical antibiotics prior to the culture report, but once they receive the culture report, based on that report, the clinicians to de-escalate or stop antibiotics, or they can change over to other antibiotics based on the resistant pattern. And coming to the antimicrobial stewardship program, am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. So antimicrobial stewardship program. So here, antimicrobial stewardship program is it's an interprofessional effort. That is, that antimicrobial stewardship team should be formed with all infection prevention professionals like infectious disease consultants and physicians and surgeons and clinical microbiologists and HIC nurses, infection control nurse and pharmacy people and the lab technicians, everybody. So based on that, so these team has to act round the clock to approve drugs for the restricted antibiotics, and for formulary restriction should be followed. All these protocols should be practiced in healthcare settings. First, this is mainly, this involves timely and optimal selection. This helps us to helps us in selecting optimal drug dosage and duration of antibiotics to treat the infections, and it aims at best clinical outcome of infections and with minimal toxicity to the patients. That is, due to overuse of antibiotics, the patients may become toxic. They may, some drugs are nephrotoxic, some drugs are hepatotoxic. So with these policies, we can minimize the toxicity to the patients treated with antibiotic and minimal impact on resistance and other adverse events as Clostridium difficile associated diarrhea, which is antibiotic associated diarrhea. So we can mitigate the development of antimicrobial resistance in a particular settings. So CDC has defined this antimicrobial stewardship as the use of right antibiotic for the right patient at the right time with the right dose, right route, and right frequency, causing least harm to the patient and future patients. So the antibiotic stewardship program is main aim to save drugs and stop bugs. So stopping bugs and saving drugs. So to make sure the appropriate and judicious use of antibiotics to improve the patient outcome, to enhance the patient safety, and to reduce the multi-drug resistance. This is a simple algorithm showing antimicrobial stewardship treatment thing. So this is like a start smart and then focus strategy. So start antibiotics. When can you start antibiotics? If there is no antibiotics are needed in absence of evidence of bacterial infection. So antibiotics should be strictly started only for bacterial infections. But at the same time, if there is no evidence of bacterial infection, so you can get the history of drug allergy and obtain culture, and antibiotics can be started in case of emergencies within 1 hour in case of sepsis, and all these should be documented, the indication for use of antibiotics and dose of antibiotics and route of administration, all these should be documented and include review date and stop date or a duration, everything should be mentioned properly. So first start antibiotics, then focus, and the clinical review should be done and decision should be taken after 48 hours. 48 hours, and based on the culture report, you can either stop the antibiotic or de-escalate. That is, you can switch over the antibiotics from IV infusion form to oral form, or else broad spectrum antibiotics to narrow spectrum antibiotics. So based on the culture report, based on the sensitivity pattern and resistant pattern of the given antibiotics, it can be either stopped or de-escalated IV to oral. It can, the same drug can be continued or it can be changed. So all these things has to be documented, and the review date and the next stop date, next review date and stop date, everything should be mentioned. So based on this algorithm, the AMSP, that is antibiotic stewardship team, has to act, and this policy has to be implemented in every healthcare setting to mitigate the development of antimicrobial resistance. Then various initiatives has been taken at the national and international level to curb the rising trend of AMR. As you all know that antimicrobial resistance has been increasing worldwide and posing a greatest threat to the human health across the globe. So various initiatives has been taken up at the national level and international level to curb such threat. So national and international, this is mainly to assess the burden of AMR and to provide some information at local and regional and national levels to take some actions to prevent such spread such development of resistance. So national and international surveillance network has been launched targeting surveillance of MDR pathogens of public health importance. So the MDR pathogens like Klebsiella pneumoniae, Salmonella, Pseudomonas, Acinetobacter, all these MDR pathogens, very important pathogens that poses a great impact on public health. So these network has been launched targeting surveillance of such MDR bugs. So finally, World Antibiotic Awareness Week. So World Antibiotic Awareness Week, every year it's been celebrated by second or the third week of November. So the aim of this antibiotic awareness week is to increase awareness of global antibiotic resistance and to encourage best practices among general public, healthcare workers and policy makers to avoid further emergence of antimicrobial resistance. So as I told before, the general public should be aware that antibiotics shouldn't be consumed without doctor's advice, without doctor's prescription. They should not take any self-medications for self-limiting illnesses or non-bacterial illnesses. They should be aware of such situations, such conditions. And this year, the theme of this World Antibiotic Awareness Week is United to Preserve Antimicrobials. So this year, the date is around 18th to 24th November 2020. So United to Preserve Antimicrobials. So let's all unite to preserve the last resort drugs, last resort antibiotics for future use. So by implementing all these infection prevention and control practices and policies in healthcare facilities and following it meticulously, definitely we can curb the spread of antimicrobial resistance and mitigate the spread of infections caused by multi-drug resistant bugs. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anita, for that comprehensive coverage of the topic.
Okay.
I would request all participants to post their questions in the Q&A tab so that we are able to bring it to the speaker. So while everyone is typing in their questions, the biggest challenge to implement these type of practices in the general populace is that a large part of our country is uneducated, is illiterate. And we also see that local pharmacists, these pharmacy outlets, etc., they also are prescribing some of these antibiotics over the counter. So when the person who walks into a pharmacy asking for a medication, a drug, and the pharmacist is also not regulated. So both ways, we are sort of compromised. So that's unique for India, I guess.
Yeah.
Within a hospital, within the confines of a hospital, programs and policies will be enforced
yes.
in full vigor. But in the community settings,
It's very difficult to create awareness among the general public in the community. So nowadays, that is a main challenge for us because the healthcare workers are already aware of antimicrobial resistance and everything. But in community, it is very difficult. We will not be able to completely curb the spread of antimicrobial resistance. So I agree that community is a major, it plays a major role in creating such resistance. So through any infection prevention posters or through social media or something like that, we have to create awareness in the general public regarding the use of antibiotics, regarding the use of the H1 drugs and the X category drugs, everything. They should be aware of such drugs because without doctor's prescription, they cannot just like that take any antibiotics or any other drugs that may lead to some toxicities in future. They should be aware of that.
Yeah, another common phenomena which is seen is that once even through a prescription, if someone is given a prescription and is in under domiciliary or maybe home care, then sometimes we see that as the symptoms improve, they discontinue completing the entire course.
Yes.
So that's a very common thing which we get to see.
Yes.
Again, public awareness around that is going to help a lot.
Yeah. So the antibiotic should be prescribed for minimum of 3 days. But based on the severity of the symptoms, the doctors will advise for 5 days or 7 days. The complete course has to be completed. Otherwise, that is again as the faulty treatment. It's that inappropriate dose. So again, recurrence of infections can occur. This recurrence of infection is mainly due to the resistant bug. Because of inappropriate killing of bugs by inappropriate dose of antibiotics, the resistant strain will stay back. So when it gets a chance, these resistant bugs again flourish exponentially and finally converts all the susceptible strains into resistant bugs. So finally it becomes a super bugs, and in that way, from that person, it can get transmitted to other persons. So in that way, it gets transmitted in the community as well as in the healthcare facility. So the prescribed course has to be completed. At any cost, it has to be completed. Without a doctor's advice, they should not just like that stop the course of antibiotics. So the doctors will correctly advise whether they have to continue the antibiotics for 7 days or 5 days. So, or else they can switch over the antibiotics from higher end to lower end. It's broad spectrum antibiotics can be switched over to lower narrow end antibiotics. Based on the culture report, they can de-escalate. So even if they de-escalate such antibiotics, the entire course has to be completed. So that they have to stop the antibiotics only with the doctor's advice. So otherwise we cannot, it is very difficult. It's very difficult to curb the spread. I feel so doctor's advice is always very important.
Absolutely. For the company. Yes. There are questions, again, maybe if you like to reiterate on superbugs, because you already had covered that in the presentation.
Yes.
But someone is requesting a revisit of superbugs. So what are superbugs?
So superbugs are nothing but these are organisms which are resistant to multiple drugs. As I told before, the multi-drug resistant bugs are nothing but these are organisms that are resistant to one drug in three categories. Suppose if a penicillin, carbapenems, these are separate categories. In each category, they will be resistant. So one drug in each category. Penicillin comes under one group, and carbapenems, which includes meropenem, imipenem, ertapenem, something like that. Penicillin is ampicillin, amoxicillin, amoxiclavulin, beta lactam inhibitors. So if the multidrug resistant bugs are organisms which are resistant to ampicillin, amoxicillin, carbapenem or imipenem, meropenem or imipenem or ertapenem, any one drug in each category, at least three categories. So these are multidrug resistant bugs. But extensively drug resistant bugs are nothing but these organisms are resistant to most of the drugs in all categories. Most of the drugs in all categories. That is more than three drugs in all categories. And pan-drug resistant, they are resistant to last resort drug also. There is no other choice of antibiotics to treat such infections. They are pan-drug resistant. So all these all these are covered under superbugs. It's a general term which it's a collective term for pan-drug, XDR and MDR. So pan-drug is more problematic because we don't have any choice of antibiotics to treat such infections. So that's why we should take strict precautions to prevent the spread of infections by PDR, pan-drug resistant bugs.
Thank you for covering with that question on XDR and PDR as well. Thank you. So one of our colleagues from the clinical team is asking, is there any antibiotic policy in India?
Yeah, we have antibiotic policies. Actually, every hospital, every healthcare setting should set up a own antibiogram. So based on the culture reports, based on the cultures reported by their own hospital, they can make up a local antibiogram in their own hospitals. So it's called cumulative antibiogram. With cumulative antibiogram, again, they can create enhanced antibiogram. Suppose if the healthcare facility comprises of 200-bedded hospital, and out of 200-bedded hospitals, like 20 beds will be ICU beds, and the rest will be, some will be OP and some will be IP patients. So they can stratify each category. like IP as kind of this kind of organisms are more common in OP department. This kind of organisms are more common in IP department, and this kind of organisms are more common in ICU. And the strain is like this. So the sensitivity pattern of such bugs in ICU. For example, Klebsiella is the most common pathogen in ICU patients, followed by Acinetobacter. Some hospitals have Acinetobacter. And we can analyze the sensitivity pattern of such bugs in particular areas. So even the microbiologist, the in-house microbiologist of hospitals can prepare a local antibiogram for their own hospital setup based on the culture reports, based on the patient's culture report they receive. So various surveillance programs has been launched mainly to streamline the data collection, analyze the data collection, and to better understand the mechanism of resistant pattern. At even a global level as well as at a national level, where various network has been launched and various surveillance softwares has been launched, WhoNet softwares has been launched. So these all, they are all working together. They are all working together to assess the burden of antimicrobial resistance in particular area, and to streamline the data collection, analysis of such data collection, and to better understand the mechanism of resistant pattern. That way, they finally they can give us a pattern of, trend of antimicrobial resistance. Every year they can easily compare whether the trend is getting increased or it's getting decreased, whether the carbapenemase resistant enterobacteriaceae are getting increased by every year, or it's reduced this year. So all these can be compared. So even all the hospitals should step forward to set up an own local antibiogram for their setup, and based on that they should prescribe antibiotics to their patients, to the OP patients and IP patients, and follow some such protocols. If they want to treat some patients in ICU, suppose the ventilator associated pneumonia and the patient needs meropenem. So meropenem drug. So they should get approval from the antimicrobial stewardship team. So in case of emergencies, there are some categories like restricted, semi-restricted, and unrestricted. So unrestricted drugs can be used. So no need of any approval from AMSP team. Whereas semi-restricted, they can use some antibiotics to some extent. For example, for 3 days, they can use without any approval. But for restricted microbial, for polymyxin B and colistin and all, they cannot use the drug more than 1 day without approval from AMSP team. Such protocols has to be set up in each and every hospital so that they can control the sale of higher antibiotics without their knowledge. They can control and they can definitely they can reduce the trend of multi-drug resistant bugs in their particular setting. Local antibiogram policy.
Right. Would the emergency department be a place where empirical treatment of some, you know, suspected infections, they start off with some antibiotics, where semi-restricted drugs may also be prescribed in an emergency, yes, and then step down can be done later?
Yes, yes, sir. So in emergency department, suppose a patient coming with a shock, and a hypotension, and no pulse and no BP, the patient may be drowning, or they may have a sepsis kind of thing. So in that condition, immediately within 1 hour, the antibiotic has to be started. Retinol is an exception. So they have to be started. But before start of antibiotic, they have to take cultures. But suppose if you are going to start the patient on higher antibiotics like meropenem or something like that, then take blood culture before administration of antibiotics. Because antibiotics has to be administered within 1 hour in case of sepsis and all. So before that, you can take blood cultures before administration of antibiotics, especially in the emergency department. And the doctors working in ER should be aware of the local antibiogram of their hospital. So they should be aware of what kind of patients will be stepping into their hospital, what kind of infections are more common in their hospital. The patients stepping into their hospitals may have some common pathogens, like E. coli may be more common in OP department, outpatient department, whereas in ICU, Klebsiella will be more common. So that kind of, the sensitivity pattern, that kind of differentiation should be known to everybody. Yeah, all the doctors sitting in right from the ER until an ICU, everybody should be aware of the local antibiogram pattern of their own hospitals, so that it will be easy for them to prescribe the correct empirical antibiotic for presumptive treatment.
Thank you. There's a question from one of our clinical colleagues. Do probiotics have a role in decreasing the impact of AMR?
Sorry, probiotics?
Would they have a role in decreasing the impact of resistance?
Probiotics, it will increase our normal flora, growth of normal flora, and in that way it will increase our own natural mechanism of immunity, so that they will not need antibiotics for their thing. But I don't think it have much role, but it can be a supplement to increase our normal flora.
Yeah, I think that was interesting from a point of view that there is a competition for the nutrition, etc. So probably from that aspect, the thought would have come that can it be a factor which can modify or influence.
Sorry, I couldn't get you properly.
So I could understand the background of the question that probiotics.
But I'm not able to see anything here in my screen, so that's why I'm sorry. I'm not able to view anything.
Am I audible? Am I?
Yeah. You are audible.
Okay. So basically, the question on probiotics, I guess, came from a background. Mm-hmm. The competition for the same area, the same nutrition, the nutrients, etc. Same. So, will there be some sort of influence?
Yes.
On the bugs, on the resistant bugs. So
yes. Our own normal flora will, if it gets destroyed, then we will not have enough mechanism, anything to come. Fight against the pathogens. So that is the thing. So probiotics can supplement that by providing, to function, to make our normal flora to function, it can supplement.
Yeah, thank you. You have already spoken about it. Self-resolving infections should not be treated, especially viral infections.
Yes.
Should not be treated by antibiotics. What other types of infections or minor ailments should not be treated with antibiotics?
Suppose if we have not during this COVID season, so usually in non-COVID season and all, we used to get a lot of common cold, right? So all the common cold, mostly they are caused by respiratory viruses. There are more number of respiratory viruses causing common cold. So viral infection has no, antibiotics has no role on a viral infection. So people should be aware of that. And also diarrheal infection. So we no need antibiotics to treat diarrhea. Self-limiting diarrheas are there. Even Salmonella and Shigella can cause self-limiting diarrhea. In such conditions, no need of antibiotics. Antibiotics has no role in preventing such infection or curing such infections. Okay, and so common cold and diarrheal diseases and any other suppose patient may have some kind of gastritis problem, acid peptic disease, and they may have some abdomen pain. They may think some kind of infection or colitis kind of thing. So they may take self-medications for that. So no need of antibiotics for such infection. So first we have to rule out what kind of infection is it. It is then only we have to go ahead with medications. So without evaluating, we should not proceed with medications. Whatever the medications, not only antibiotic, whatever the medications, without evaluating properly, we cannot take self-medications.
Thank you. Ma'am, you spoke about category one, the critical organisms, the pathogens,
yes.
The priority pathogens. Yeah. And you also spoke about that for especially these pathogens are responsible for bloodstream infections, pneumonia. Now,
yes.
We also parallelly talk about the importance of hand hygiene and how to break the chain of infection. So,
yes.
And among the common methods of achieving hand hygiene is soap and water. The other one could be a hand rub based on isopropyl alcohol, 70%, or a 70% isopropyl alcohol with 2% chlorhexidine.
Yes.
So for category one organisms, which one is the most appropriate? Because many of our clinical associates who are attending this call and any practitioner who are in ICU settings and putting lines or caring for central lines would be keen to know what is the ideal method to take care of those
problems. Alcohol-based hand rubs are more than enough. Alcohol-based hand rub. So except for Clostridium difficile associated diarrhea, when you are treating Clostridium difficile associated diarrheal patients, then soap and water is needed. Otherwise, alcohol-based hand rub, alcohol-based hand solution is more than enough. That is effective in killing all bugs.
Thank you.
So only for Clostridium kind of thing, soap and water is suggested.
Thank you for that very, very crisp and clear guidance. So there's a follow-up question, I think on the same line, can hand hygiene help fix the problem of antibiotic resistance? So whether prevention is the mantra now.
Hand hygiene is the only thing, the first and foremost thing to prevent any kind of infection is hand hygiene. All steps of hand hygiene has to be followed. Everybody should be aware of WHO recommendation of recommended steps of using hand rub or hand wash solution. There should be thorough and hand washing practices and using hand rub thing. So we should properly follow such protocols. It should be done meticulously and very frequently. And also proper cleaning of environment, cleaning and disinfection practices of environment is very, very important. All the healthcare workers, whoever is involved in environmental cleaning and practices should be trained, and they should be aware of the methods and the methodology of using the solutions, and correct composition of a disinfectant should be used for some areas, and they should be trained in using in such techniques. So first thing is hand hygiene, another one is environmental sanitation and environmental cleaning and disinfection. So these are the two things that has to be followed in healthcare setting as well as in the community. So I think this could prevent the further spread.
I'll ask the last question maybe for the session. So in your experience as a clinical microbiologist, infection control officer, and you also mentioned about some departments, some specialties wherein opportunistic infections do happen at an increased rate, like for example transplant settings or
yes.
Oncology settings, etc. So are these so basically would there be a separate strategy for that, or or it will be the same for the entire hospital?
Yeah, they are more prone to get infections, especially opportunistic infection. Usually every individual will have wound commensals. Okay, so especially these kind of patients are already immunocompromised. They may have the commensals and more pathogen, but they may be resistant. Resistant strains may be sitting on their own body. So when their immunity is still more compromised, like while undergoing procedures like bone marrow transplantation or other organ transplantation, or just a Foley's catheter insertion or central line insertion or intubation, there are more chances of the sources may be endogenous source. So already the bugs are sitting on their own body, and during the such procedures, it gets entered into the body and it can cause infection. Such patients are already immunocompromised, and in addition to that, the bugs whichever is infecting such patients are multi-drug resistant or extensive drug resistant bug. So we will not have any choice of antibiotic to treat such patients. Though the patient outcome will be very, we will not have good outcome, good clinical outcome. We will not have any clinical outcome. It cannot be, these are the reasons for increased rate of mortality and prolonged bed stay. So all these are the challenges we are facing.
Right. And would you propose accelerated education training of personnel in these departments? So from an education training point of view, would the efforts be more accelerated?
Yes, of course. So everybody should be trained, especially the infection control nurses should be trained, and they should be in a position to train other nurses in their own department. So everybody is responsible for this. It should be a team effort. It should be a teamwork. We need full cooperation. The entire hospital team should have a proper coordination and cooperation among all the departments, including laboratory and pharmacy and ICU critical areas and OPD departments and nursing team and infection control team. Yeah, there should be a good coordination between all these teams. It's very necessary.
Yeah. There's a last question which has sneaked in. Sorry to keep you holding up. So there's a question. Do you think overuse of chlorhexidine in hand rubs, etc., would increase the chance of resistance to chlorhexidine while doing hand hygiene?
No, not likely. No. It is not like that. So chlorhexidine is essential in critical areas, high critical areas, especially when we cohort patients infected with MRSA, methicillin resistant staph aureus. So chlorhexidine is suggested in handling such patients. This is to prevent cross infections, because the healthcare workers who are handling the MRSA patients can carry the infections from the patients, and they can transmit the infection to other patients if the same nurse or healthcare worker is going to handle the other patient without proper hand hygiene. So in such situations, chlorhexidine is suggested. Chlorhexidine with alcohol hand rub is suggested. Especially it is suggested for MRSA patients, when we handle MRSA patients. So it will not cause any resistance. As of now, we don't have enough data to justify that.
Right. Thank you very much for patiently answering all those questions. And we're very sorry for the technical glitch. But I'm sure that towards the end, we could fix it somehow. And all the participants would have benefited immensely from your talk today. I would also like to thank the Polymed team, who is working in the back end. So they're the force behind this. So Mercy, thank you very much. Ravi, I don't see him on the call, on the panel side. Ravi, thank you for your leadership. Sundar, I can see you there. Pooja, thank you very much. The marketing team, the IT team, thank you all. Thank you all participants for taking out time and connecting to this webinar. As many of you would have attended many of our webinars. So we do keep having these webinars quite consistently on very important topics. So please do stay in touch with Polymed, your nearest contact, to get an update on what's coming in next. And last but not the least, thank you very much, Dr. Anita, for taking our time and presenting on a very important topic and raising the awareness among all these healthcare practitioners today.
So thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be here to share my points in this session. And thanks for giving me this opportunity. I would like to thank your organizers from Polymed team and the marketing team, especially Mercy, who has come forward to ask about this and convey this information and give me this opportunity. It's my great pleasure to be here. And once again, I thank you all for giving me this opportunity. I thank all the participants and for their patience to be here to hear my session. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am. Look forward to having you once again in the near future. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah. Thank you.